Welcome to IT Edits episode. Well, we're not doing episode numbers anymore, I don't think, are we? So, IT Edits, and we'll call it The Idiot's Return, I think, this one.
You're an idiot.
I'm going to go straight on to the... What? So, off to a flying start. So, yeah, we're back again after about a year. So, before we talk about what we've been up to, let's just cut to the chase and say what we're doing in this episode. So, yeah, we're just going to talk about where we've been, what we've been up to, because we're... None of us at the same company anymore, are we?
No, either of us. Has happened?
Lots changed. And well, we're back again, so yeah, we've been away for about a year and a half, so got some new ideas. Well, actually not new ideas at all, we're just going to do the same thing with new technologies, basically, aren't we?
Yeah.
And yeah, just finish off with a bit of Hyper-V. So yeah, that's the
sounds
idea.
Good.
So, who are we? So some of you might be new to us, or some of you might have seen some of our other podcasts, so... We're not new to podcasting, but you might get that impression by looking at the quality of our podcast. I spent a lot of time and effort trying to sort the sound situation out.
We should have brought that mic.
Didn't work, sort out, but we couldn't deny it again, so we're using the same crappy mic. So sorry about the hiss. Sufe's going to try and cut that out, and you'll be the judge on how successful that will be or not.
Thank you.
So, yeah, we're back again. And... That's it. So what, what's really going to change? Nothing's going to change. We're on YouTube now. So we're much more of a podcast now. We realise that, yeah, podcasting's not for everyone, especially video podcasting, because video podcasts, they're a bit big, aren't they? And that's all. So we're going to try and get the website up and running again.
Yeah, so it's going to, we're going to have more content on the website. Yeah, are we going to do the audio podcast as well?
Thinking about an audio podcast, not quite sure what content to put in it. I mean, we did do a new show called Unwatchable, which lots of people liked. Quite happy to do that one again. But that's about it. So what have we been up to? So job-wise, if you haven't met us, we're both working in IT.
Yeah.
So I do myself first. So.
Well, I'm glad you admit that on camera that I work in IT, because, you know, he's normally not so forthcoming. But anyway...
So work in IT, have been working in IT since I left university, and pretty much work as a Microsoft consultant and focus on technology system center. Although if you've been working in Microsoft for a long time, as we shall show you, it's quite straightforward to pick up. So our approach to this is, if it says Microsoft on it and it starts with Microsoft, it can't be that hard. We're going to give it a go.
No, it's if Nikki can do it, so can you.
Cool.
That's
so
pretty much it.
So that's what I do. So I'm focused on the system center side currently at the moment. We both used to work together at a company called Eurodata.
Yeah.
And so I've moved on from that.
We've both moved on from that. So we don't work together anymore.
Nope.
Yeah. But we still pretty much do the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
You're a technical architect of some description.
I don't know what my job title is. I'm pretty much doing the same kind of thing, which is focusing on System Center with an eye on the whole Microsoft portfolio, whereas you do the
SharePoint.
T. Oh, sorry. What was that?
Also known as the T, probably. Yeah. So I'm a SharePoint consultant, and that's what I do. Not too much to say about it, but yeah, working with a different company now, more and more hands-on, which... It's a good and bad thing, but yeah.
Cool. So, and that leads on to the next bullet point, why are we doing this again? So, I mean, the first round of podcasting was quite fun. We had a lot of fun doing it. We had some good feedback. We built up a nice little community, bar a few, and we had a lot of fun. And they've all gone now, probably moved on.
Yeah.
But to be honest, we learned quite a lot doing it. And it's quite good for me to struggle through these technologies and going through these new things, showing you. And it's been kind of valuable to me. Also, I'm still meeting people at events and at work who still say he's building IT Idiots. And yeah, I kind of feel a little bit sorry that it's all gone. So I thought I'd give it one final push. There's lots of exciting stuff going on IT-wise, technology. I mean, things have moved on in Hyper-V, which our previous episodes, we focused a lot on that. Things have moved on a lot there. System Center's totally new. SharePoint's changed a bit. She'll move on to that at some point, I guess. And
So, I mean, you're right. I mean, I'm really looking forward to this new series, although we haven't filmed it yet, because it's a learning point for me. I'm gonna be the idiot in most of the episodes, try and show you up when the SharePoint episodes come online. But yeah, that's about it.
That's it. And maybe you've got to speak up because you've got a crap.
Oh, sorry.
So you can see even on the editing of the slides, this is the this is the kind of quality you can expect from us. But yeah, we sort of just to put a few slides together. What we're going to focus on first is, or what we're going to do is try and pretend to run a real functioning IT organisation, referred to as IT Idiots.
Yeah.
So in this organisation, and again, pretty much mimics the previous podcast, in this organisation, it's all going to be based fundamentally on Active Directory Windows 2008 R2. Now, we might play around with 2012,
mm-hmm.
but I upgraded both my servers to 2012 and they both died.
Okay.
So I don't really want to touch that too much at the moment. So our foundation is going to be set nice and stable, so it's based on that Active Directory. And as most companies will do, you run a mail server, so stick Exchange in there. Mm-hmm. Haven't really played much with Exchange 2010, but you know, I've met a few people dealing with it, and mm-hmm. after speaking to them, I realised it can't be that hard. So Exchange 2010, we'll deal with that. Then we're on to your flagship, SharePoint.
SharePoint.
Now, SharePoint is a bit of a weird one, because where I deal a lot with just putting a system in and run away, SharePoint, I mean, I could put a SharePoint system in. I'm quite happy to do that. I reckon I could do a pretty good high-level design of SharePoint.
You reckon?
But I wouldn't be able to do anything other than give you my site. So there's lots of design elements to SharePoint, which is why you're involved.
Yeah, it's just slightly different in terms of it's more end-user oriented and it's very, you know, highly customizable. So where perhaps if you deliver an Exchange project, at the end of the day, everyone gets email. And yes, they might have it more reliable if your design's a bit better and it's more resilient and all that. But SharePoint, it really is up to the individual organization what they want to do with it. And there's a million ways to collaborate as well. It's not just one single way. So to me, that's where the key difference is.
Cool. So move on to SharePoint. And when you look at SharePoint, it's based on, well, it stores a lot of data and that's stored in SQL.
Pretty much all of the, yeah.
So we need to cover SQL because, yeah, everything seems to be relying on it. I specialise in System Center 2012. You can't do anything without SQL Server nowadays on that. So, yeah, we need to spend a bit of time on SQL. I guess what we'll do on this, because I told you why I'm doing this too, because it helps me learn things. So I want to get onto System Center as soon as possible.
Yeah.
So probably what we end up doing is building up Active Directory, installing SQL, not paying too much attention, get onto System Center. That's my ultimate aim on this.
Okay.
And trying to fend off SharePoint as long as possible. So
can't fend me off forever.
Anyway, you do the editing, so that's
yeah.
So again, the idea, so we're going to build this lab. You're going to see us build our domain controllers, build our servers, etc. And with all these technologies, we're going to need quite a few servers. So, obviously, I don't have, I live in a two-bedroom flat, not much space in here. So, how are we going to put all these servers in here? So, we're going to use virtualization technology. So, you guys, the idea is you can follow along with this with your laptops, your desktop machines, using the virtualization technology of your choice, VirtualBox, Freebie, one out there. Don't know so much about that, to be honest. I know lots of people use it and it seems to be a good one. VMware is my personal favourite for a VMware workstation on a desktop or laptop machine. But for me, the ultimate is really looking at Hyper-V. And the reason I'm using Hyper-V, or the reason we're going to base this on Hyper-V, is A, selfish reasons. It's what I deal with on a day-to-day basis, so it's good for me. Also, limited resources I've got here. Mm-hmm. You know, I plan to run this ideally on maybe one or two servers, and we'll show you how we're going to build that server. And maybe in the next episode, you'll see us build that server. And with dynamic memory, we can really squeeze, you know, as many servers as possible onto that machine. Now, VMware's, when you start looking at the server products, they have got this built in. But again, for me, Hyper-V, nice and simple, easy, very easy for you guys to follow along. It's an industry standard out there. And if you're running the beta of Windows 8 already, you realise it's actually part of Windows 8. So
there's no separate licensing?
None at all. Okay. So obviously you've got to license the VMs you're installing, but it just means that all the VMs I'm running here, mm-hmm. I can port across into a Windows 8 laptop mm-hmm. and take them. And hey, there's an idea. I could put a domain controller on my laptop as well. So in this episode, what we're going to do is look at a bit on Hyper-V and building up how you can build up your first mm-hmm. server. So in the previous podcast series, we had two servers I was kind of proud of. And there were, one of them was a 99 quid server, and the other one, I don't know, 120 odd quid or something like that. But the problem was they only could support a maximum of 8 gig, which nowadays is nothing. You can't run many VMs on that at all. You're only running SQL, System Center. You've got to have a few clients as well in this little lab. So you need to, well, one of them's still there. The other one broke, actually. So they've gone.
Define broke.
I'm not sure the power supply actually went on that.
Right.
It's in the front cupboard.
Okay.
By the front door, actually. So what I wanted to do is have some kind of hardware or have some kind of cheap way of running as many VMs as possible. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to spend too much money on this. And what I did have is I had an old desktop machine, which and had a couple of 160 gig drives on there. And I thought, well, what I could do is just take that desktop machine, because I hadn't used it for ages, and kind of rebuild it as a server. So initially, this is what I did, and we call this the old server. And I'm using server in quotes here, because they're just desktop machines, really. And when I bid out on it, so I got an Asus motherboard, and the main thing is I want a socket 1155 so it can deal with the Intel chipset, and that cost me 62 quid. I bought an Core i7, which cost me 205 quid. I think these were plus VAT, you know, these prices. And coming onto this, didn't need to buy an i7 really, it's kind of a waste of money, because you're never going to use that kind of spec on this server. And in terms of memory, initially I've always bought decent memory, like Crucial memory, because I've had problems with cheap memory in the past. However, when I looked at Crucial memory costing 240 quid for 32 gig and looked at this memory, which is by Computer Bay.
With a K.
And I thought, what a great company name. And that was 130 quid from Amazon. I thought,
It's got Bay in it.
It's got to go for it. So it's 130 quid. It's 32 gig. I put it in an hour ago. Yeah. It seems to be quite stable. And I bought it based on reviews on Amazon, which I do love user feedback, and had 7 positive reviews, and they all seem to be running VMs. So I thought, let's give that a go. So that's 130 quid's worth.
So can we go back to the processor a little bit? So that's Intel Core, that's one core.
It's actually quad core.
Quad core.
Quad core, yeah. So it's quad core i7. And on the next server, which is the one hopefully you'll see us building the next time, I'm just going to go with an i5, I think. Because really, when you look at the servers, what you need is you need to put as much memory in these things as possible.
Yeah.
That's really going to affect the amount of VMs you can run in a lab environment, in this kind of lavish environment. Now, I decided to go a bit flash, literally, on this on storage, because I often run out of VMs once a night. Might get bored, let's fire up a VM, see what's going on there. And it takes time to spin up and fine. I'm kind of bored and just wasting time looking at process files. Now, on this Mac, this first Mac I got was solid state drive. And since that, I can't touch mechanical drives, I hate them. My new company, I've got a work laptop, it's got a mechanical drive, can't use it, so I'm using this at the moment.
Right.
So I thought, when I left my last organisation, I actually put the solid state drive in, that was the company that you and I worked for. I took it out, it's 250 gig drive, I thought, I'll stick that in the server as well. And I stuck the Crucial 256 solid state drive in there. The price of that at the time was 180 quid, and I love it.
What's the price now?
Price now, and we'll come on to that on the next slide.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll move on to that one. Okay. So this is the old server.
But yes, my 2 cents to that is my new company laptop is solid state and brilliant. I run all my VMs on it. They boot up really quickly. The only thing was, I think because of the price, mine is 250 gig and I've run out of space already.
Yeah, so with solid state on that on your server, you've got to think on this, it's 256 gig. Mm. And at the point, I think the first one I bought was about 250 quid, you know, and they've come down again. So what I did have lying around, I've got 260 gig drives, solid state drives. So I've stuck them in there and I've put them as a stripe. So I should get some reasonable performance on that. So my idea with virtualization is to put the main VM, so if I'm running System Center, I'm going to put the OS VMs on the solid state drive, but things like the distribution drive, I'll stick a VHD file, and if you don't know what we're talking about, you will do, on the slower drive. So that will give us some reasonable performance. So
a stripe is you use both, and they're not redundant?
There's no redundancy at all in stripe, yeah, so if one of them dies, I've lost all the data.
Okay.
And talking about solid state, the first solid state drive I did buy has broken. So, looking back in that. So that was the old server, which I'm going to introduce us to in a second. But the new server, and this is the one I'm
Which you
looking
haven't
at,
bought
which
yet.
I haven't bought as yet, because every day they come down, and the honest truth is, since I've got 32 gig in that other server, there's a reasonable amount of life in that. So the new server, the problem I've got with it is I'm storing them in a cupboard next to my washing machine, so I've got limited space. So this one is going to be mini, sort of micro ATX, so a lot smaller. So I found an ATX case with power supply, and you've got to be careful with power supplies as well, because dodgy power supplies do have reliability issues as well in terms of making the machine unstable, crashing through, I guess, not clean power. Mm. So I'm spending £23 on that, because they're that important, and it's extra value. And the Asus...
And it's piano black.
It's piano black, yeah, matching my new car, Mini. And...
yeah, the Lotus is... Well, you still have it.
Lotus is actually dead at the moment. It's in a Lotus garage. But yeah, it was 11
it died
years old.
When you were driving it over to mine.
Yeah, it saw the Mini and decided, F you, and it just blew up on me. But anyway, you'll hear a lot more about the Mini in the coming series, I'm sure, because it talks, isn't it?
It's awesome.
It is cool.
And in fact, I think we should do an episode just on that. Maybe like a snippet one, a 10-minute one.
Good too. Right. So the motherboard, ATX, £85. And this motherboard, it's got all the storage, all the video. You don't need anything special for your server in there. It's got pretty much everything on that. Again, computer bay, 32 gig, £130 on that. Go for an Intel Core i5, £145. And again, the same Crucial solid state drive, £165. So if I top that up, 300, so 445, about 550-ish, I reckon. So for £550, now if it works, you probably want to see if this works before you buy it.
So stay tuned.
And it's not a bad amount of money to spend, £550 for a machine which, you know, you could learn. This could take you through your MCSE. I've always learned much, much better by playing around myself rather than going on courses.
Absolutely.
You know, and with this, you could do so much. You could run so much on this. You know, I'm running real Hyper-V servers at work, or dealing with customers of 32 gig. So this is a good machine. So that's pretty much the introduction to that. Now, what I'm going to do is flick magically, because I'm running a Mac. Go away.
I'm going to cut that out.
What? The flick?
The flicking.
Okay. And let's close down Word. So the flick. I'm going to cut that one out again.
Yeah.
Flick. Right. So all I'm doing is I'm RDPing to my server. So this is my old server recording. Of course, the new server is yet to be assembled. And you can see this is my solid state drive in here. And I'm going to zoom into here because I've got dodgy eyesight, and it'll also help you guys see as well. So you can see my C drive on here is solid state, and I've only got 200 gig left of it already. There's my stripe in there. This is loaded up with just a few ISOs which we're going to use. Mm-hmm. So that's just sort of pre-populated in there. So
this server is currently... only has the operating system with updates.
Just the operating system.
It.
Literally installed a couple of hours ago.
Yeah.
Got the memory, stuck it in, installed it. So the first thing you need to do on this server, and you know, if you've bought this server or you're running along, you just need to add a Hyper-V role to it. So I'm just going to go to Manage, go into Roles in here, and click on Add Roles. And if you are building your server and you're putting your processor, you need just to make sure it supports virtualization. To that, so I can just click on Hyper-V. Now probably what I'm going to do is, because this is, I'm not going to have many physical machines, this machine is also going to be a domain controller later on, but that will be a bit later on, and I know that's not a good idea in real world. Right, this server's only got one network card as well. Now in real life, I'm speccing up a Hyper-V server at the moment, they've got 10 network cards in. So with one network card, what can you do? Not a great deal, but you can do pretty much everything that we want it to do. What it's asking me now is to, I'm running Hyper-V, and it's asking me to create a virtual network that those Hyper-V machines are going to, you know, be able to participate on. Mm-hmm. So that virtual network is just going to be connected to or associated by a real physical adapter,
okay,
which means my virtual machines can see out of that server. So click on Next, Install.
It's quicker. Oh.
And it needs to restart. So it will need to restart, but because it's solid state, that should be quite nice and quick. And whilst it's rebooting, What I want to talk about is the storage space. So 190 gig, not a great deal of storage space on that. And I thought what I'd do this time around, and this is something I haven't done before because I haven't been bothered, is try and use something called, God, I forget what they're called, on VMware, they're link clones, but using...
I forgot too. You said that...
Differencing disks.
Okay.
That's the one. So my idea is, do they just want to install an OS, Windows 2008 R2, install that as an OS, so that would take, let's use one virtual disk file, let's say 20 gig. It's not going to be that big, but let's say 20 gig. And then what I can do is make that read-only VHD file and create a differencing disk off that. So the differencing disk is another VHD file, and it's referred to, and that's its parent. So when you boot it up, it's literally seeing into that VHD. It can't write to that. When it wants to write, it writes to that VHD.
But all the updates that you do on that.
Yeah, so initially it's going to be quite good. So in theory, I can have that 20 gig VHD file and I can spin up 9 servers from that. Mm-hmm. And those 9 servers will be, well, 20 gig or just over. But when you start updating them, they're going to grow and grow and grow and grow and grow. So the differencing disks are great initially, but they will get bigger and bigger and bigger. So hopefully as I just chatted away, the server should be up and running. Ooh. And my fan's going mental now. So I'm just going to connect across and I'm going to go straight into my Hyper-V console. Actually, when I go back into Server Manager.
So what's the difference between that and Virtual Machine Manager?
Virtual Machine Manager, let me just remote back onto this. Virtual Machine Manager, we will come to that a bit later on, but that's useful for managing multiple nodes in one go. I don't know why I just got kicked off that server. So that's the Hyper-V manager, but what I need to do is just peek back to have a look at this. I don't know, because sometimes it needs a double reboot for some reason. Right, so there's my Hyper-V server. What I'm going to do is go into the Hyper-V settings and just do a little bit of configuration. So on my solid state drive, I'm just going to create a couple of virtual directories. Virtual directories. A couple of directories. One called VHDs.
I like to call mine virtual machines, personally.
And one called VMs.
Oh. Okay, this is different.
Mm.
So because with VMware, which I use, would you split them up like that as well?
No, the honest truth is I generally put them in the same place.
Okay.
It's kind of strange because when you look at the virtual disks here, if you were to create a new virtual disk from this console, that's where it would be. But if you create a new virtual machine, and whilst you create that virtual machine, you create virtual disks, they go in that location. So the likelihood is all my virtual disks will be in the VMs directory anyway. And the VHDs is just going to keep my parent disk.
Oh,
that's
okay.
That's the idea. But I set it up accordingly. Let's put the virtual disks. And yeah, you might be hearing my fan now. Again, gives you some idea of the quality. And let's just modify this into VMs in here. The other thing you want to do in your servers is, or when you're building up your test lab, is you want to get all your ISOs ready. So on my second hard disk, I've got my Strike 1, I've got my directory ISO, and I've got a lot of ISOs in there. Now, where do you get these ISOs from? Well, I don't know. If you're serious about sort of going down this route and learning, and I really think you can get max from this approach, you might need to lay out a little bit of cash.
Subscription?
Well, yeah, TechNet Plus costs £200 or thereabouts plus VAT, and it gives you access to all of the products with the Microsoft product suite, and you're licensed for it to use in this kind of environment. So it's a nice clean way of using it. Or you can just use evaluation software. You know, I'd be very surprised if this lab lasts 180 days. you know, it might get rebuilt or something. So you can use eval software as well, but get it all downloaded and get it ready. So what I'll do first of all is let's create my first virtual machine. Now the idea of this virtual machine is this is going to form the parent virtual hard disk.
So what do we have here now? It's Node.
This is just Hyper-V Node, yeah.
Okay.
Hyper-V Node, yeah. And I'm going to call this one underscore win2008R2 parent. Store in a different location. They don't seem to have thought very thoroughly about, you know, where it defaults to these locations. Even on the new System Center 2012 products. What am I doing? I'm creating a VM, aren't I?
But you want it to be the parent.
This is true, but I'm going to do it this way. Because it's not a parent yet, it's a VM.
Okay. So and then you'd move it across.
Yeah, I'm going to move across later. And on this one, I might as well, I've got 30 gig, haven't I? Let's give it, might as well give it 4 gig. Can't be bothered to use dynamic memory.
Miser.
Who needs that? And we can see this virtual machine, we're connected up to here. I'm happy with that as the virtual disk.
So once it's connected to that LAN, does it have access to the internet?
It will do, yeah.
Because the host has access to the internet.
It's just the host is on a network and that's got, it'll just get an IP address from my router or router if you're not English. ISO. So all I'm doing now is putting the Windows ISO in this. Can you see it? There it is. Yeah, I've got older. Eyesight's got worse. Got grey hair now as well. That's the other. Some of the other things that have changed. All right, and finish that. Now, so my ISO's on the solid. No, my ISO's on this Stripe drive, so it's reasonably quick. But this thing's going to build on the solid state drive. So let's just start this up and check out how quickly this installs. So I think I've got the process of installing or using differencing disks right. I read an article about it, but I haven't done this before. But again, that's the kind of way we roll. Because I like learning through struggling as well.
Yes, because you remember it better, trust me.
Yeah, sometimes if you just read it and do it and it works, you just think, oh, that was easy, and you don't understand anything. Well, why is it not connecting? There we go, okay. So let me just full screen this. So English United Kingdom, next, install now. Now, what I could do with this differencing disk is be really clean and create a 50 gig partition and, you know, install the OS in the 50 gig and then install the, whatever, the System Center on Drive D, but I can't be bothered with that, to be honest. Of course, it's good practice, but again, we want some speed in here. So I'm going to go with Enterprise Edition, just in case I use a bit of clustering later on.
Okay, what's the difference between that and Core?
We're
going to cover that.
We will do Core. Core's a great idea. It's a minimized attack surface. It doesn't support a GUI, so they say, but it just looks like Windows with running command prompt. Don't know how successful that was. I raved about it when it first came out. I did lots of a few Hyper-V installs on Core Server. No one touches it anymore. No one really considers it much anymore. You just get hurt.
Yeah. The problem we've got was just drivers. You ran into some trouble, didn't you?
With HP drivers supporting Core and their configuration stuff. Right, so I'm just going to do an install. You can see default drive, happy with that. As you say, I could go 50 gig, but it's going to use dynamic disks anyway, so it won't grow above.
Okay.
So let's just install that. So that was nice and quick.
So what would the advantages of Core be?
Advantages of Core is it's a minimized attack surface because it's not running a GUI, it's not running IE, can't run IE, so therefore there's less things to attack on it. Okay. There's fewer processes running. So fewer things running in memory, it's not supporting GUI.
So performance-wise, it should be better.
Arguably, it should be better.
Okay.
But, you know, process, I've never seen a processor in production being maxed out.
Mm.
Never. So, you might be fast-forwarding this bit, Sifei.
Okay.
Right, back. Okay, so that didn't take so long. I wasn't timing, but I suppose you can see on your screens how long that took. So that's okay. So usual Windows 2008, the first time you install it, when it's makes you change your password, which in my lab is always going to be the same.
Password one.
Oh yeah, a bit of a hint on your lab. When you say on your lab, maybe security's not that important to you at the moment. So set up a domain policy that makes sure your pass or change your policy to make sure your passwords don't expire.
Oh,
Because
yeah.
otherwise it's bloody annoying. I had to reinstall my lab because I lost my admin password. Because I
Oh.
was forced to change it and I realised what the problem was. I changed it on a machine that had number lock on. And I can
So
never log on again.
you do that via a domain policy, because I normally
Yeah.
just go into the user account and just tick never expire. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean you can also do that, but it's kind of a bit more global, isn't it?
Good. So you can show me how to do that.
Right, so the Windows 2008 machine's up and running, and this is going to form the basis of our template. So we're going to fast forward again in a second because really the next thing we're going to do is just get the thing all updated. So if I apply all the Windows updates to this machine, obviously when I form all the other servers, they're going to be bang up to date.
At
So
that point.
at that point. Yeah, unfortunately, you can't go back to the parent and update the parent VHD file because it will break the others. So the best thing to do with this parent is once this is all up and running, once it's fully updated. I mean, I could put Office in there, I could put other things in there, so they're always there on all my machines, but I don't think I'll bother. What I'll do is I'll shut this virtual machine down. I'll copy the VHD file into another directory and mark it as read-only
Okay.
because if you can make a stupid mistake. I am the person to make it.
So Hyper-V, because I don't know much about it, because I normally use VMware. Snapshots then, does it handle that?
Yep, got snapshots, but they're going to take up space in the solid state
Yeah.
drive, so I'm not going to do that.
Okay, so
But actually, I could put my snapshot location on the other drive.
right, so you would, because in a VMware environment, I would build a base,
Yeah.
shut it down, snapshot it, and then do link clones from that
Yeah.
snapshot. So that's similar.
I've got to admit, on VMware, you're talking about
Yeah.
VMware Workstation. Oh, my stomach. It definitely deals with the whole concept a lot better.
Right.
Because with this, well, you'll see how you create it. You've got to create the difference in disks before you create the virtual
Okay.
machines. So it's very, very different. So 70-odd updates. So what's the time?
202
It's
meg.
202 meg. It is. Let's accept this. It is 5:16. Let's see how long this takes. Oh
Hmm.
no. I cancelled it again.
I think you accidentally did a stop download.
So 5:16, what's the download going to be like?
So what's your internet connection
I think
like?
it's the internet connection. I mean, I'm on Virgin, much like, oh, you're on Virgin as well.
Yeah.
I think I'm on 50. I'm not sure. But I get very, very patchy experience with it. You
Wow.
know, very. It seems to be like at the weekends. If I want to download something big, like an entire season
Game of Thrones.
of game. I don't play games. I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh,
No, it can be. It can be. Yeah, quite slow. But I don't know if it's my router actually. I'm not sure. The trouble with Virgin now is it's all integrated. Is this interesting or should we fast forward?
no, yeah, let's do a break here.
Okay. Okay, so we're all back. Let's just log on to the machine again. I think sometimes when you get to Windows Update, there's a couple more, isn't there?
Yeah, when you run it again, you'll
Yeah.
notice that. And I always run it again and again until there's no more.
So let's just quickly do that again. I mean, some of the other things I was thinking about doing on this machine is we could, theoretically, you could put the admin tools on it so they're always there on all the other machines. But I don't think I'd bother with that. Let's just go Windows Update. I didn't select the optional ones either, did I? Look, eight optional.
Three.
Three optional. It's dodgy eyesight. So, I
You're
don't
not
know.
going to do the important one. Oh, you're going to do all of them.
All of them, yeah. That's right, isn't it? Why did it go to
I don't
two to
know.
three?
That's weird.
Hopefully it's not a reboot one. But anyway, what's the time? 5:30. I don't know what
Yeah.
time we started.
23, I think.
23, so solid state. So that is the way to go. Let's check out how much disk space I've consumed. So 184 I've got left. And we're in another fast forward moment, I think. So we're back on our. I just full screen that to make it look a bit tidy for you guys. And that's about it, really. I think I've set up as much as I want to in terms of that. But you could put your admin tools in there. You could even install Office on it. But I haven't got time for all that stuff.
On a server?
Well, it just means that it's always going to be there. Because often when I want to look at files, I download
Yeah.
and just makes your lab. Bit better, but obviously more updates, they're going to get bigger. So, if you've got nine machines running Office, they want Service Pack 1, that's
Yeah.
they're just growing and growing and growing. Anyway, so what I need to do to this machine is something I was almost forgot until you reminded me, Sifei, and that's run a something called sysprep, system preparation. Because what we're really doing is we're going to clone this virtual machine, okay? And if you clone a virtual machine, you realize it takes on the entire personality of that machine, including this thing called the SID. The security ID or something like that, and yeah, you can't do that. It's bad, bad thing, bad thing in a domain.
You have quite a lot of conflicts.
You do now in a test lab, and in the last podcast, you probably seen me say, "Yeah, you don't want to be doing that." But in a lab, I generally get away with it. I have got away with it, but sometimes System Center don't like it.
Yeah, Exchange doesn't like it either.
Yeah.
But I have read an article, I think it was a TechNet blog, that said there's actually no
Arthur's.
problems with it.
Not a recipe. No.
But I know that when I tried to install Exchange, it just complained. It didn't like it. So,
Okay, so what I've got to do is sysprep this machine, and it removes the personality of this machine and just means I can clone it from that point. So sysprep's now in the hard disk. It's now local. You don't need to drag it from anywhere. I can't remember it's in System 32,
System32.
is it? Hey, don't you tell me what to do.
Yeah.
Right, so CD sys.
Or you can browse to it from Windows Explorer and double click on sysprep. That works too. Yeah.
Yeah, I kind of feel. So what we need to do is just tick on that generalize box, and there we go.
Don't, no, don't do reboot.
And I'm gonna make sure it's on shutdown. Because otherwise, yeah, if you do reboot, it'll come back up and go into
Yeah.
the mini setup wizard again. So this sometimes takes a little while. I haven't done it on 2008 for a little while, but we'll see how long it takes on solid state drive. Might be fast forwarding in a moment, who knows?
Nah, it shouldn't take that long.
We're shutting that and shut down.
So once you've shut down, any machine that you create off that base machine, they'll come up with sysprep ready when you
Yeah,
boot it
they'll
up.
go through the mini setup as if that machine, as if I'm just starting up that machine again. So what I'm going to do is go into the VMs, go into that folder, and just pick up the VHD file. And what I'll do is I'll just cut it and copy it into. I could put it on the other drive actually, couldn't I? Well, I just put it into VHDs. Not quite sure if I believe in this structure I've created here, to be honest.
Because why are you leaving that parent folder there?
Don't know. It says VHD. It's a VHD. Does it need further categorization?
No, are you going to delete that other folder?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, I don't know, because what I might do is cut that VHD for the other server on the VMs. So when the other server, I'm just trying to find an excuse for why I'm not what I did. What I did. I'm failing badly. No. Here, about this one. We can copy the virtual machine to the new server and then start that up and do Windows update again.
Okay.
That's why I did it. I make this read-only so I don't make any mistakes onto that one. And a little bit of pre-creation or a bit of preparation now. So in my VMs folder, because what you've got to do is you've got to create them as differencing disks before you create the VMs. So I'm going to create ihq-mail-01, which is the mail server. I will create an ihq-sql-01, the SQL server.
Where are we going to put the DC?
The DC is actually going to be the physical machine.
Oh, okay.
HQ dash. I mean, we could have a DC. Hey, we got the memory, haven't we?
Well, no, we can do that later if we want to.
Do I put the DC? What I'm thinking is, well, I'm going to have a DC to run this. Now, I could have a virtual DC. We've got limited physical boxes. Now, if we have the domain controller needs to be up and running before any members of that domain are up and running. So you always got the problem where if I put the Hyper-V host machine in the domain, well, the domain's not going to be up and running
until
it's up and running. And you might say, well, just leave the node outside the domain then.
Yeah.
But when we move on to System Center, these nodes have got to be in a domain.
Right.
So the only way I've come, the easy way to do that is just make the physical machines Hyper-V nodes and domain controllers, which is not good practice in real life, but
it does for us,
yeah. So what's our next SQL server going to be?
You've created a blank one.
Oh, sorry, our next server going to be IHQ dash.
SharePoint.
What do you call that?
You can call it SharePoint. You,
it's got to be four characters, really.
Four?
Four, I can...
SPS?
SPS?
Yeah.
SPS. SharePoint.
Yeah, SharePoint server, yeah.
Yep. Okay, so I've got the little folder structure there. Let's go back into Hyper-V Manager and let's say new. Oh, it is there. Hard disk.
Okay.
So the hard disk I'm going to create, it's not fixed. It's not dynamic, it's a differencing disk.
Okay.
Click on next. And the name of this, let's just put this in the relevant directory. See what I mean? I don't know why it's dumping me in that C program files when I explicitly stated earlier that I wanted to use the C drive. VHDs. No, I'm going wrong here, aren't I? So, VMs. And this is going to be the mail server. So it's like that. And I will just call it ihq-mail-01.
And we've got two dots.
Click on next. And specify the virtual disk that you want is to use as the parent. And again, it chooses a random folder. So I move into VHDs and choose that as the parent. Just click on next. And finish that. So I'm just going to do that another couple of times. I don't know if you want to fast forward that or... Are we going to make them see this?
No.
I suppose they can fast forward watch this, can't they? Yeah.
Yeah, I'll fast forward at this part.
Oh, it's put me in the right place now. Never done this before. I haven't. Is it the dots in there, isn't it? Just goes back to the last place, doesn't it? Is that right?
No. Are you not referencing the VHD now?
Oh, yeah, it's parent, wasn't it? I wasn't reading. Really.
Oh, yeah. I think that's what you're doing.
Who knows?
So that the virtual you want to use as parent, yeah. Okay, so we're back.
So I've got those three disks.
So would you consider that cloning?
I don't know, it's a tough one really, because they sort of are clones, aren't they now? they're just using the same parent partition, and any differences are going to be stored in, let's just have a look at them. So if I go into mail in here, into that VHD file, which you can see is 321K. So what would be good would be to create that mail server now and fire it up and have a look at that disk file. So new virtual machine.
Oh, so you have to create the disk first and then the new...
Yeah, okay. Well, as I said, I haven't done this before. I've done it in VMware before. And what I read before, it said you've got to create the disks. So I thought, save a bit of time, I just create the disks. But what we can do now is we can see if we need to do that. So ihq-mail-01. Click on next, and I will give it its mail server. Let's give it... Well, actually, I'm going to use dynamic memory on this. So I'm going to say 512. Unfortunately, on this wizard, you can on server 2012, you can't specify dynamic low and high when you're creating it. You have to go back into it. So I put 512 because that is always the start. So create new virtual disks. No, you see, you can't, can you? Create a new one.
Right.
It's just a big one. So we're going to use an existing virtual disk. Quite exciting, really, isn't it?
Okay.
Huh?
No, again.
And there's our mail server there. Click on next. Finish. So that's that. You might think, oh, I've created the name. How could you do that? I got the name wrong.
What did you put?
HQ mail.
Oh. IH.
I'm using IHQ. And the reason I'm using IHQ, because it was IT, its headquarters. However, it can be quite useful to screenshot for this, for sort of work, and it's not good having IT bits in your work documentation, so IHQ is a bit for
generic, yeah.
Unless you've seen the podcast. Right, so that's my IHQ mail. Now, I could start that now, but let's build up a bit of suspense. Let's create another virtual machine. And this is going to be ihq-sps-01. Oh, I think it actually puts it in a subfolder for you anyway. SPS. Five 512, that's fine. Let's go into catch that virtual network. And again, we're using our differencing disk. Browse. Click on next and finish. So what I probably do is just pop into settings of these and just alter the memory so I can just flick them to dynamic memory. So we'll put the mail server, I'll give that 4 gig max, as I have plenty of memory at the moment. And how much memory do you want?
4, please.
2.
I should say 8.
Yeah, dynamic memory is really cool. You got a SQL server, it would just use it.
Yes.
So now are the days I'm seeing where people are actually having to configure SQL servers. You notice that?
Yeah.
Because normally it's just installed and that's it.
Yeah. They've got to go in the settings and go throttle it.
In the new system standard 2012 products, they warn you, they sense that, saying, well, you're crap, basically. Right. So, I will connect to one. And what we do, I won't even power it on, I'm so confident this is going to work. Let's go into VMs, let's go into mail in here. Let's have a look at that disk file as we start that up. It's better work.
So what are you expecting?
I'm expecting it to start up into Windows 2008 into mini setup. It's going to grow a little bit because writes have got to go into this directory, and you can see it's starting to already. And I'm not quite sure why it's taking such a long time to connect to them. What I'll do as well is I'll just start up the SharePoint server. Might as well.
Yeah. Ooh. Is growing rapidly.
Yeah, so all the rights to it. But remember, those rights can get overwritten.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I don't know what they could be. Temporary files, could be anything. I mean, what was the size of the parent drive? That's probably quite useful information, isn't that?
Ooh.
So about 10 gig. 10 gig. So, you know, we are saving a reasonable amount when you count those servers up. But as you said, the updates, every time you update, they're going to grow and grow and grow. So just going through a little sys prep, giving it new SID. The mail now.
Not even a gig yet.
Not even a gig. Okay, so, and you can see this is just the, oh, Trinidad and Tobago, how cool is that? you can see this is just the mini setup wizard I'm popping through. You can give them all keys if you've got the TechNet Plus license. So you just read that. And away we are, so new server, and I'll leave that there. Let's just make sure the SharePoint server is up and running. SPS, let's connect to that. And that'd be going through the same sort of mini setup wizard. The other thing to notice, if you look at these servers, dynamic memory, look at the memory demand that mouse server's got on it, 280 meg.
So moment. That's what it's currently using, is it?
No, I gave it a startup memory of 512 meg, yeah. So that's what it would use, but it doesn't need that much. But you see, it defaulted to the United Kingdom, yeah. It's because I guess the parent was on UK. Next. And again, that's that one. So, two servers up and running, not using much memory.
So, it's strange that the SharePoint server waited till you connect it to it before it ran through its connected.
I think that must have been a fluke, because the point you connect doesn't have anything to do with it, as far as I'm concerned, if I'm aware. Yeah, you can see when I created the VM, I nest it in the right directory and it creates a directory for me. So when you're doing it, you don't need to create that further directory again. But hey. Not a bad start, I don't think. Yeah. So what we've done is we got our server up and running using Hyper-V.
Mm-hmm.
Just explained a bit about what perhaps you could do to build a server, mm-hmm. or, you know, a reasonably cheap one. Of course, 16 gig or 8 gig you can start on it. Fine with that. And again, solid state drives. Not that expensive nowadays. I know 170 quid for 256 gig is quite a lot.
But makes all the difference.
Yeah, it depends what you're doing. If you're working in IT, yeah, it's a no-brainer. It really is, because I mean, all of this, I'm an employee instead. I'm not a contractor, but I use my own money on this because it just makes my job easier and I get that time back.
Mm.
Do you know? You get it back. So that was it. And we've got.
So what are we going to do next time?
So next time, well, we've got the new server to order, but the next thing we need to do is build a domain controller. Mm-hmm. We need to set up the domain. So the next episode, what we'll do is we'll get the IT Idiots or IHQ domain up and running,
mm-hmm.
and we've joined this. Oh no, we won't join this because this will be the domain controller. And so we just set up the domain, talk a bit about Active Directory for those guys who haven't seen any previous episodes.
Yeah.
And the one after that would be server.
Great.
So until that time, which hopefully will be in the next year.
In this year, you mean?
In this year.
Until then.
Yeah. And any hints on microphones will be good.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Great. Yeah.
We need help on that.
Bye.
Bye.